Hello, welcome back. In the previous lecture, we have seen the methodology of logical atomism, how the principle of logical atomism can be used as a methodology in doing philosophy. And we have seen there are two steps, there are two aspects, the analytic as well as the synthetic aspects. And in today's lecture, we will be looking into the ontology of logical atomism. Whenever I say the ontology of logical atomism, it's not dealing with the ontology in a physical sense. Ontology, as you know, is a part of metaphysics which deals with existence. Whereas here, existence doesn't mean physical existence, but here it is logical existence. So when we speak about the ontology of logical atomism, what we are referring to is not the existence of objects in the external world, but how we logically apprehend the objects in the external world. It's not dealing with the object as such, as an entity, but the way we look into the object. So that's where the ontology of logical atomism becomes significant. And we can see that metaphysically logical atomism is the view that world consists of plurality of independent and discrete entities. This position goes against the idealist metaphysics, especially that of Hegel, Schelling and all. For them, reality is one, indivisible one, an absolute one. But Russell's position or the logical atomist position is in opposition with this position of idealism, the position of unity. Here, world is not seen as an absolute entity, but as an entity or as a collection of independent and discrete entities. There are different entities that can exist independently. So, it's a pluralistic metaphysics. Again, metaphysics doesn't mean objects, thing as entities, but as conceptual entities. These entities come together to form facts. There are objects in the world. We'll make it clear later on. There are objects in the world, and objects are the unit of our identification, how we identify things. This pen is an object, not in the sense of physical object, but in the sense of a conceptual object. The conceptual pen cannot be further divided. So, the pen can be divided into parts, physical parts. You can make any number of parts out of the pen. But the conceptual pen cannot be divided. So, the entities or the objects are conceptual objects in logical atomism. And these objects come together to form facts. The pen is on my hand is a fact, where the pen as well as the hand unite together in a fact. So these entities come together to form facts. The simplest sort of fact is known as atomic facts. In atomic facts, only two or simple number of objects are in union. They are related in certain way. That is atomic facts, the simple unit of our understanding. We can understand a thing by a word or concept and a fact using a thought. That is atomic fact. An atomic fact may be formed either by, there are two ways in which the atomic fact can be formed. They are either by a single individual exhibiting a simple quality. That is the pen is black. A simple individual, the pen, which is an entity, is black, simple quality. So when a single individual is associated with a single quality, then it becomes an atomic fact. That's one way of forming the atomic facts. The other way of forming the atomic facts is multiple objects standing in a simple relation. That's what I told earlier. The pen is on my hand. Multiple objects, the pen and hand, in a relation of on. So that's multiple objects forming or standing in a simple relation. So there are two ways in which atomic facts can be formed. Either an object exhibiting a quality or multiple object in a relation. That's the two ways in which atomic facts can be formed. And the atomic facts are the simplest ways of representing fact. It's the simplest way. The relation may be dyadic, triadic, and so on, depending on the number of individuals involved. When there is a single individual having a single quality, then it's a dyadic relation because there are only two objects. When I say this pen is black, the notion of pen and the notion of black is associated in an atomic fact, and this is dyadic. When more than two things, three things are associated, then it's triadic, tetradic, and so on. So the atomic facts can be divided in that way. Then logical atoms are logical symbols, and by logical symbols what we mean is that we cannot further debate that concept. The concept pen cannot be further divided. The hand, the physical hand, comprises of fingers. So the physical hand can be divided, but the conceptual hand or the logical atom, what we call hand, cannot be further divided, because there is no further logical division for that concept, that logical atom called hand. So they are logical symbols. They are devoid of any complexity. They do not contain it. So in order for a thing to be complex, it must have more than one element. So since they are logical symbols, they are devoid of complexity because they do not have multiple elements in them. They are made out of simple element. So there is no complexity in the logical atoms. And these logical atoms are the results of logical analysis. When you divide an experience into simpler pieces, what we have seen as analysis as a methodology. When we divide an experience into simple elements, simple pieces, then the end of that analysis are logical atoms. So if you divide, then ultimately you will reach a concept which cannot be further divided, and that is the logical atom. And they are the limits of analysis. That's what I told earlier, just before. They cannot be further divided. So they are the limits of analysis. It's out of these logical atoms that propositions are constructed. Whenever you say the pen is black is a proposition, that's constructed out of logical atom pen and black. Black is also a logical symbol, logical atom. So pen is a logical atom, black is a logical atom. So when they join together, then propositions are constructed. It may be simple or complex. And since atoms are the result of logical, that is philosophical and non-empirical investigation, they are logical atoms rather than physical atoms or ontological atoms. The name logical atomism is due to this. That means when these atoms are result of logical analysis, as I told earlier, this is not a physical division or physical analysis. This is not a material analysis, but logical. In our thought, what's happening? In our thinking, the conceptual analysis. So it's a philosophical analysis or non-empirical. It doesn't relate to the physical world. It is related to the conceptual world. And it's a non-empirical investigation. They are logical atoms rather than physical atoms. They are not referring to physical. So that's why the name logical positivism came to this approach. Sorry, logical atomism came to this approach. Okay. Now if you take logical atomism as a language analysis, then it presupposes the isomorphism of thought, language, and the world, or thought, language, and reality. If you want to think of the world outside, if you want to think about the objects in the outside world in terms of logical atoms, see, three things are utilized. We think about the world, we are thinking and is about the world, and we use words to think about the world. That the world, words which represent the logical atoms, pen, black, and all. These words are used. So words are used, we are thinking, and it is about the world. Three things. So that corresponds to thought, what we are thinking, language, the words, and the world, the objects. So, if you want to represent the world in language, in our thought, then the world, language and thought, all three, these three things must have the same form or structure. And having the same form or structure is known as isomorphism. So, if you want to represent the world in language using our thought, the world, language and the thought must be isomorphic. And isomorphism is basically a term used in chemistry for showing crystalline structures, having similar crystalline structures. So, here also, only if the world, language and thought have the same structure, can they be represented in word. So, it presupposes the isomorphism of these three things. The methodological and the metaphysical elements of logical atomism contribute towards the formulation of ideal language philosophy. Now, in methodological logical atomism, as a methodology, you have seen that you can analyze a complex scenario, a complex experience, you can analyze into simple one, and you can put them together, so synthetic phase, in the synthetic phase. And in metaphysical logical atomism, the metaphysical aspect of the ontology of logical atomism, you have seen that the facts can be represented using words. Now, in one part, you can divide things into simpler objects, and in the other part, you can represent them by language. Now, this makes it possible to represent the reality in language clearly and unambiguously. And that is the agenda of ideal language philosophy. So, the two aspects of logical atomism, that are the methodological as well as the metaphysical approaches in logical atomism, contribute towards the formulation of ideal language philosophy. And in such ideal language, the atomic facts are represented by words. Each and every atomic fact, the simplest unit of our understanding, is represented by words. And the relation between atomic facts are represented by logical constant. That is, relation between atomic facts, okay, is represented by logical constants. Logical constant, you have seen that and, or, then identical, all these things are logical constants, what we call truth functional connectives. An atomic proposition is simplest form of complete sentence. So, when you represent a fact in language, when you represent a simple fact in language, you get an atomic proposition. Or when you represent atomic fact in language, you get an atomic proposition. They are the simplest sort of complete sentence. The truth or falsity of atomic proposition would depend upon the corresponding atomic fact. Pen is black is true only if pen is black. So, the truth of my statement depends on the existence of fact in the world. So, the logical atomism or ideal language philosophy in general means subscribe to the correspondence theory of truth. The theories of truth you might have studied earlier, that there are mainly three theories of truth: correspondence theory, coherence theory and pragmatic theory. There are other theories also, but mainly these three: correspondence, coherence and pragmatic theory. And the ideal language philosophy as well as the logical atomism subscribes to the correspondence theory of truth, that something is true only if it corresponds to the world. Then molecular propositions are derived either by combining atomic proposition are derived by combining atomic propositions using truth functional connectives. You can get a molecular proposition which is a compound proposition using the combination of atomic proposition by truth functional connectives. This is how logical atomism can be used in language analysis as a tool for language analysis. Now, we'll conclude the session on logical atomism, what we have seen in the earlier class as well as in today's class. We'll conclude just now. Logical atomism presupposes the pluralism of reality. So, it requires the pluralism of reality. As we have seen, it's not against the monistic tradition. So reality is pluralistic in nature, and also it presupposes the isomorphism of thought, language and reality. So two things: there are many objects, there are pluralism of objects in the world, and they can be represented in language in our thought. That's the second part, the isomorphism of thought, language and reality. It reduces ontology to logical symbols or logical atoms. The things in the world can be reduced to logical symbols, or there are limits about the things in the world, and that final limit is known as logical symbols or logical atoms. The method of such reduction is logical analysis. You can reduce your experience of the world into simpler unit, and that is known as logical analysis. The logical symbols are used to reconstruct body of knowledge in new vocabulary. Whatever we understand about the world in a normal way can be reduced into logical symbols and again reconstructed to form a new, reconstruct in a new vocabulary to reformulate our knowledge. And this is what we have seen in the analysis of definite description in Russell in the earlier classes. And the logical analysis along with atomistic ontology help the theoretical construction of logically perfect language. That's the ideal language. The logical analysis, that is the methodological part, and the atomistic ontology, that's the ontology of logical atomism. These two things helps the theoretical construction of logically perfect language. This contributes towards the ideal language. This logically perfect language is devoid of ambiguities. We have seen that earlier. And that's the whole project of ideal language philosophy, to make an unambiguous, precise language. Since philosophical problems are the outcome of incorrect use of language, the reformulation of the existing system of knowledge in the new language can solve the philosophical problems. According to ideal language philosophy, most of the philosophical problems arises out of the incorrect formulation of reality in language. It's a problem of language. So if you reformulate the reality in an unambiguous language, there cannot be any confusion or there cannot be any ambiguity in the use of language. And this can solve or rather dissolve the philosophical problems, because there are no real genuine philosophical problems. If you want to quote Wittgenstein, there are no genuine philosophical problems. So you are not actually solving it, but you are dissolving it. You can use it to dissolve the philosophical problems. And that's all about logical atomism. In the next class, we will come with another topic. Till then, bye. Thank you.